the glory of the risen Lord. Who can compare with the beauty of the Lord? Forever He will be the Lamb upon the throne. I gladly bow my knee and worship Him alone. I will proclaim the glory of the risen Lord, who once was slain to reconcile man to God. Forever You will be the Lamb upon the throne. I gladly bow my knee and worship You alone. All heavenly earth, the glory of the risen Lord. Who can compare with the beauty of the Lord? Forever He will be the Lamb upon the throne. I gladly bow my knee and worship Him
alone. Majestic You are, my eyes meet Your gaze and my burden is lifted. Your word is a lamp to my feet, Your hand swift to bless and Your banner a shield. You are my everything. You've placed inside of me calls out Your name. Lord, how resplendent You are when I think of Your heavens, the work of Your fingers. What is man that You are mindful of him, yet You've crowned him with glory and caused him to reign. My
Greetings to our viewers from around the world. Hope you had a great week. There are a few scriptures in the Bible that are difficult to understand. Some are confusing, while others seem to be out of sync with what we know about the nature of God. What is the meaning of Genesis 1 verses 1 to 2? Did God create the earth without form and void? If not, what happened? What beginning is the Bible talking about? When did time begin? What was there before Adam and Eve? When did the devil come into the picture? When did God create the angels? When did Lucifer and his angels rebel against God? Was there life on the earth before Adam? What happened to that life? Who were the giants that lived on the earth? What happened when the sons of God mated with the daughters of man? Who were the sons of God and who were the daughters of men? What is the connection between the sons of God and evil in the world? Where did the contact between Satan and man begin? How deep was that contact? And what bearing does it have for us today? Why did mankind always have the tendency to go against God time and time again? Why did they insist on worshipping idols when God persistently and continually showed them that He was the only true God and there was no other God before Him? Why does God appear to be harsh and cruel in the Old Testament and kind and loving in the New Testament? Did God change? Now, these and many other questions have come to our mind, I'm sure, from time to time, and we have wanted answers to them. We got some kind of answer at some time, but we don't know for sure whether those answers were right or wrong. We will look into that a little more deeper in this particular message, in the message that follows next week. I will answer these questions, some of them today and some the next time. In order to do so, we have to start from the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth. Genesis 1 verse 1 says that God created the heavens, not heaven, singular, but heavens. Obviously, there are many heavens, but only one earth. We are told that the universe was created 13.8 billion years ago from a singularity, which was as small as the point of a needle. There was an explosion which took place in a nanosecond, and the universe was created from particles moving away from each other faster than the speed of light. Scientists have measured the universe through the Hubble telescope and the latest telescope, which is called the James Webb Space Telescope, that can see light at least 13 billion years ago. In other words, this telescope can see and measure when the Big Bang actually took place. We have found that the universe is 94 billion light years across. The heavens include all this and more. What we have determined as the universe is what we have discovered so far. I'm sure there's a lot more to discover than what we've discovered so far. And that will probably surprise all of us when we actually see that happen. True science and true religion agree with each other. Science tells us that the earth is 4.5 billion years old and living creatures lived on this earth, and some even looked like human, almost human. If God created the heavens and the earth in 6 days, how can it be possible? There are two schools of thought on this subject, the old world creationist and the new world creationist. Both do not believe that all creation evolved by blind evolution. The New World creationists believe the earth was created in literal 24-hour days. The Old World creationists believe that the earth and all in it was created over a long period of time. This thinking agrees with the scientific fact that the earth is old, that there could have been creatures living on this earth long before man. Let us look at what the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 10 from the New International Version. He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. There is a place far above the heavens from what we understand as our universe. And we think our universe is anything outside the earth. But it could be far, far more than that, far greater than we can imagine, far beyond our universe. 2 Corinthians chapter 12 verses 2 to 4 tells us, 2 Corinthians 12 verses 2 to 4 says, I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Now this is Paul writing about a heaven called the third heaven. Whether it was in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that this man, whether in the body or apart from the body, I do not know, but God knows, was caught up to paradise. He heard inexpressible things, things that man is not permitted to tell. So here we see that Paul is speaking about a third heaven, and there could be more heavens than that. We don't know. The Bible does not explicitly refer to other heavens, but it is believed that there could be more. The point is that when the Bible refers to the heavens, it means more than our known universe. God is greater than we can imagine. We cannot grasp the full nature of God because God is unlimited. We are limited. But still God is disclosing himself to us as much as he can possibly grasp. There is more to God's creation than we can understand. A long time ago, even before the universe as we know it was created, angels populated the heavens. Lucifer was one of them. We read in the Bible in Ezekiel 28, and we look at this spiritual realm that we know very little about today. Let's look at that spiritual realm and we'll understand something that's happening right now on this earth is far greater than we can imagine. Ezekiel chapter 28, verses 11 to 17. The word of the Lord came to me. Son of man, take up a lament concerning the king of Tyre and say to him, this is what the sovereign Lord says. You were the model of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone adorned you. Ruby, topaz and emerald, chrysolite, onyx and jasper, sapphire, turquoise and beryl. Now obviously this is not talking about actual king of Tyre. It's talking about another king. A king who was not on earth but in heaven, living in the Garden of Eden, which is not a earthly Garden of Eden that was created later, but a heavenly Garden of Eden that was far more beautiful than the Garden of Eden on this earth probably was. We don't know for sure. Going on, it says, your settings and mountings were made of gold. On the day that you were created, they were prepared. You are anointed as a guardian cherub, for so I ordained you. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked among the fiery stones. You were blameless in your ways from the day you were created till wickedness was found in you. Through your, and notice this thing, widespread trade, you were filled with violence and you sinned. We'll go back and see what this widespread trade was all about. Going on in reading this, it says, "So I drove you in disgrace from the mount of God, and I expelled you, O guardian cherub, from among the fiery stones. Your heart became proud on account of your beauty, and you corrupted your wisdom because of your splendor. So I threw you to the earth. I made a spectacle of you before kings." He's talking about kings. What kings? The angels were in heaven. After they were created, the earth was created. The angels were there at the creation of the earth. We just read in the book of Job, in the last message that was given last week, it says here Lucifer was an angel specifically created by God and anointed or set apart for a special purpose. And we saw in the book of Job that the angels shouted for joy at the time of creation. And it's talking about a creation before our creation, or the creation for human beings. And this Lucifer had a special place in God's hierarchy of angels. He lived in Eden, the garden of God. He was better than the other angels created by God, probably in a higher position than the other angels. When iniquity was found in him and he was thrown to the earth. Why? Because he corrupted the earth with his trade. So Satan traded with someone on earth. They saw him fall. Who were these kings? Surely they were not the kings that lived today on earth. If they were kings, then they were kingdoms, and they were civilizations populated by intelligent beings who were our predecessors. Archaeology has discovered many beings that lived on this earth several thousands of years before human beings. They have also found remains of human-like creatures and cities that date back to prehistoric times. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 45, verse 18 in the New International Version again. It says here, "For this is what the Lord says, he who created the heavens, he is God. He who fashioned and made the earth, he founded it. He did not create it to be empty, but formed it to be inhabited. He says, I am the Lord and there is no other." Obviously, God created the earth perfect and habitable, but it later became chaos and confusion. So there is a big gap of time between Genesis 1:1 and Genesis 1:2, a great span of time that passed during this period. God created the earth perfect before he recreated the earth during the time of man. Who destroyed the earth? Satan and his demons when they were thrown down to the earth. Satan, shining star of the morning, as the Bible calls him, became darkness and an adversary to God and was thrown to the earth. The earth was destroyed and covered with water. Genesis chapter 1 verses 6 to 7, God tells us about the waters. He did not create the waters at that time. These waters were already there that covered the earth. What God did at that time was, as mentioned in Genesis 6 and 7, is that he separated the earth with the water from the dry land. That's what he did. He created dry land. Obviously, the destruction that took place earlier covered the earth with water. Noah's flood was not the first flood. There was an earlier flood during the time of the rebellion of Satan. The second flood came during the rebellion of man. Genesis 1 verse 16, again, I'm not going through these scriptures by reading them necessarily, but you all know these scriptures very well and can go back to it. Genesis 1 verse 16 is not saying that God made the sun, the moon and the stars. They were already there. He only cleared the atmosphere that was causing darkness on the earth. So the sun and the moon and the stars could be seen by by the earth and by mankind on the earth, and he created day and night. So what was the light that is mentioned in verse 3 of Genesis 1? The light is God. He came to do his work on earth and take away the chaos and confusion and cause and bring about order and perfection. So there was an earlier creation when the foundation of the earth was put in place. It was made perfect because in Job chapter 38 verses 6 to 7 in the New International Version, it says here, on what were its footings set? Or who laid its foundation while the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy? There may have been living things on the earth and even human-like creatures with intelligence before man came on the earth. Satan traded with them. Satan is a thief and a liar. Obviously, his trading practices were not fair and the earth was filled with violence. Did Satan force the earlier creation of God to do his bidding? Was he trying to control the earth and all of creation? Yes. When you read the scriptures, you can see that's what happened. And he wanted more. So he ascended to the heavens. God did not create the devil and his demons. He created Lucifer and his angels who chose to rebel against God and become his adversary, meaning Satan. If we go to Luke chapter 10 verses 17 to 24, it says here, the 70 came back triumphant. Now this is talking about the time of Jesus Christ when he sent out 70 people to preach the gospel to the people surrounding and the people around there. And they came back with their experiences of doing so. And so it says here, the 70 came back triumphant. Master, even the demons dance to your tune. Jesus said, I know. I saw Satan fall a bolt of lightning out of the sky. See what I've given you? Safe passage as you walk on snakes and scorpions and protection from every assault of the enemy. No one can put a hand on you. So here Jesus was sending these disciples out to give them experience of how they preach the gospel to the world. And they were just preaching the gospel in a small area at that time. But they would be doing that later. And he was giving them the experience they required. Goes on, all the same, the great triumph is not in your authority over evil, but in God's authority over you and the presence with you. Not what you do for God, but what God does for you. That's the agenda for rejoicing. At that, Jesus rejoiced exuberant in the Holy Spirit. I thank you, Father, Master of heaven and earth, that you hid these things from the know-it-alls and showed them to these innocent newcomers. These 70 were going through an amazing experience at that time. And Jesus was directing their focus of where it ought to be. Everything, all their success, all the demons that were cast out was not done by their power. It was done by the power of God, by the Father. Yes, Father, it pleased you, it goes on to say. Yes, Father, it pleased you to do it this way. I've been given it all by my Father. Only the Father knows who the Son is, and only the Son knows who the Father is. The Son can introduce the Father to anyone he wants to. He then turned in a private aside to his disciples. Fortunate the eyes that see what you're seeing. There are plenty of prophets and kings who would have given their right arm to see what you are seeing, but never got so much as a glimpse to hear what you are hearing. But never got so much as a whisper. So what we find is here that Satan fell like lightning from heaven. Satan fell like lightning from heaven. Science tells us that the dinosaurs and all the prehistoric world was destroyed by fire. Was this fire due to a big meteor striking the earth? It is known that even a meteor the size of a football striking the earth at the speed of light can cause a gigantic crater several miles wide, generate a great amount of energy, more energy than the atomic bomb that was thrown on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, throw up tons of dust into the atmosphere and even cause the earth to be covered in dust and gases, causing darkness that will kill all those that survived the impact of the meteor over a period of time. So that's how the earth was destroyed. It was destroyed when Satan was cast down to the earth. Everything on the earth was destroyed. Isaiah chapter 14 verses 15 to 17. Isaiah 14 verses 15 to 17. What a come down this, O Babylon, day star, son of dawn, flat on your face in the underworld mud, you famous for flattening nations. What nations? Not the nations that are there today. Yeah, he's doing that today also. But he did that at that time before man came on this earth. You said to yourself, I'll climb to heaven. I'll set my throne over the stars of God. I'll run the assembly of angels that meet on sacred Mount Zaphon. I'll climb to the top of the cloud. So, you know, Satan was not content with all the nonsense that he did on the earth. He decided to go and take over, not just become like God, to be God, to take over from God his throne and to control the angels and everything that God had created. That was his purpose. That was his goal. Going on, he says, I'll take over as king of the universe. But he didn't make it, did you? Instead of climbing up, you came down, down to the underground dead, down to the abyss of the pit. People will stare and muse. Can this be the one who terrorized earth and its kingdoms, turned earth to a moonscape, wasted its cities, shut up its prisoners to a living death? So you can see what was happening here. This is the situation that took place long before man came on this earth. What nation is being talked about here? Surely not the nations of this earth as we know, but the prehistoric world. So Satan interacted with the earth before man came on the earth. They were created beings on the earth, nations and kingdoms, and Satan did his evil work amongst those people or those beings. Satan is violent, a thief, and a destroyer, and all that he touches, he destroys. He does this both physically and spiritually. Let us now look at Isaiah chapter 14, verses 12 to 14 from the New International Version, where it is not mentioned New International Version, it means the Message Bible. It says here, how you have fallen from heaven, O morning star, son of the dawn, you have been cast down to the earth. You who once laid low the nations, you said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven. I'll raise my throne above the stars of God. I will sit enthroned on the mount of the assembly, on the utmost heights of the sacred mountain. I will ascend above the tops of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. So Satan's pride got the better of him. He was so proud that he thought he will be able to overthrow God. He'll have a coup and he'll destroy, take away God's throne and actually sit on that throne, or take God out of the throne and sit on his throne. What was wrong with Satan wanting to be like the Most High? Satan was not created to be like the Most High. He was not destined to become like God. We were destined to become like God. We were made in the image of God. Angels were made to serve God. They were never created to become like God. We were created to become like God, to become his sons and daughters. God is great. No one can take God's place. No one on anything can take God's place, including man. But God, in his love for mankind, has chosen to make us his sons and daughters. we will be with him, but not him. We cannot become gods or little gods or anything like that. We are just sons and daughters of God. And that is a great privilege and an honor, something that we don't really deserve. God put Satan and his demons in their place by what he did. He and the angel disqualified from being angels. They were therefore called Satan, and demons are fallen angels. Though we do not know when Lucifer and his angels were thrown to earth, we know that Satan and his demons, which comprised one third of the angels, were thrown to earth when they rebelled against God. Revelation chapter 12, verses 4 in the New International Version. Revelation 12, verse 4 says, "Then another sign appeared in heaven, an enormous red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns on their heads. His tail swept a third of the stars," and the stars mean the angels, "out of the sky and flung them to the earth. The dragon stood in front of the woman who was about to give birth, so that he might devour this child at the moment it was born." Now we are coming now to the time of our time. And it's talking about a woman with a child and you're waiting to devour the child. This scripture is talking about Satan and the third of the angels, first of all, who were cast out with him to the earth. After all that had happened, we do not see any change in the nature of Satan. When he found that he was no match to God, he chose to destroy his creation and all human beings who God loves. He hates us because what he desired so much to become like God is destined for us, not for him. Satan knows that he has a very short time to do his dirty work. He does not know when that will happen, yet he is convinced, and he's convinced himself, that he will be able to thwart God's plan. So he is doing everything within his means to succeed. Satan is a powerful being. When I say Satan, it includes all the demons and all the fallen angels. There are different categories of demons having different positions and powers in the hierarchy of demons. In heaven too, there are different kinds of angels holding different responsibilities. They even look different. And this is indicated in Revelation chapter 5. Go there. Verses 5 to 12. It says, "One of the elders said, 'Don't weep. Look, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David's tree, has conquered. He can open the scrolls, can rip through the 7 seals.' So I looked, and there, surrounded by thrones, the animals and elders, was a lamb, slaughtered but standing tall. 7 horns he had, and 7 eyes, and 7 spirits of God sent into all the earth. He came to the one seated on the throne and took the scroll from his hand." Now, when you see this description, you know it's talking about Jesus Christ, the glorified Jesus Christ. "The moment he took the scrolls, the 4 animals and 24 elders fell down and worshipped the Lamb. Each had a harp and each had a bowl, a gold bowl filled with incense, the prayers of God's holy people. And they sang a new song, 'Worthy, take the scroll, open its seals, paying in blood, you brought men and women, bought them back from all over the earth, brought them back to God.'" Going on. "Then you made them a kingdom, priests for our God, priest kings to rule over the earth. I looked again. I heard a company of angels around the throne, the animals and elders, 10,000 times 10,000 their number, thousands after thousands after thousands in full song. 'The slain lamb is worthy. Take the power, the wealth, the wisdom, the strength. Take the honor, the glory, the blessing.'" Going on in Revelation 7, verses 13 to 15. Just then one of the elders addressed me. Who are these dressed in white robes and where did they come from? Taken aback, I said, and this is John, he's seeing all this thing and wrote it down in the book of Revelation. Taken aback, I said, oh, sir, I have no idea. But you must know, that's why they are standing before the throne of before God's throne. They serve him day and night in the temple. From these scriptures, we get a glimpse of heaven where God's throne stands. Angels of different ranks and responsibilities serve him day and night. And what we see is what John saw, or John is trying to explain to us, something that is unexplainable. And he's doing the best he can to explain to us what he saw. Revelation 15 verses 1 to 8. Revelation 15, 1 to 8. I saw another sign in heaven, huge and breathtaking, seven angels with seven disasters. These are the final disasters. This is talking about the end time, which is yet to come. The wrap up of God's wrath. I saw something like a sea made of glass, the glass all shot through with fire, carrying harps of God triumphant over the beast, its image and the number of its name. The saved ones stood on the sea of glass. They sang the song of Moses, servant of God. They sang the song of the Lamb. Mighty your acts and marvelous, O God, the sovereign strong, righteous your ways and true kings, king of the nations. Who can fail to fear you? God, give glory to your name, because you and you only are holy. All nations will come and worship you, because they see your judgment as right. Your judgments are right. Then I saw the doors of the temple, the tent of witness in heaven, open wide. The seven angels carrying the seven disasters came out of the temple. They were dressed in clean, bright linen and wore gold vest. One of the four animals handed the seven angels seven gold bowls, brimming with the wrath of God. They who lives forever and ever, smoke from God's glory and power poured out of the temple. No one was permitted to enter the temple until the seven disasters of the seven angels were finished. Let us remember that John was describing what he saw in a vision. His description was limited to what he saw and the language he could use. What he saw far exceeded, as I said earlier, what is the reality of heaven, God's power and glory. All John could do was do his best to describe the indescribable. Why have I gone into great details about this period before God recreated the earth? Because it shows us the power and the glory, his power and his glory, and his ability to create creatures we cannot even imagine. Also, it shows us the sequence of events that culminated in the creation of man and the impact Satan had on the prehistoric world. In the next message, we will look at the impact Satan had on human beings and this present world, the influence Satan had on all of us. So there is a lot more we can understand and see in all this. This world is, and whatever has happened, the history of this world and the history we don't even know of, because we know only the history of what has happened since man was created. There was a creation before that. We don't know the history of that creation. All we know is all we have in the Bible. And what the Bible gives us about whatever happened is just a mere gist, because that's all we need to know at the moment. And all the work that Satan did at that particular time in the world. We should be careful not to underestimate Satan, but at the same time, we must realize that God is all-powerful. His influence goes far beyond what Satan can ever produce. that God is the only God, the most powerful God. Satan would love to put himself in the place of God, and he's actually done that. And people worship him today. They worship the false gods. Satan can only do what God will allow him to do. God has the power to eliminate Satan anytime he wishes. He, however, has allowed Satan to do his work, because that work will ultimately work for our good in the end. There is no contrast between God and Satan. Satan is no match to God. So let us understand that, let us realize that. And sometimes we may ignore Satan on one hand, which is also not good. We need to know our enemy. At the same time, we should not think of Satan or overestimate Satan. We should neither underestimate or overestimate Satan. He is very powerful, and he has done a lot on this earth. Even right now, he is working very hard to ensure, or try to ensure, that God's will not be done on the earth. But he cannot succeed. He just cannot succeed, because God is all powerful, and he is going to bring about what he has planned to bring about. And we are a big part of that plan of God for this earth. So let us praise God and thank him for this great privilege and honor that we don't deserve. Thank him for giving us what we have. And above all, thank him for giving us the knowledge and the understanding that there were many prophets of old who never really understood, but we understand today. You need to thank him for the Holy Spirit that works in our lives on a regular basis and teaches us so many things we never would have learned or understood. Thank God for all those things, because the God we have is so beautiful, so loving, so generous. There is none like him in all the universe. So let's pray to this mighty God. Our great Father in heaven, our Creator, our Redeemer, the one who has done things beyond imagination, your power and glory permeates the whole earth and all the universe. Thank you for being what you are. Thank you for, in spite of being so great and so powerful, you think about us puny human beings living on this earth, beings that often rebel against you, beings that are many times your enemy. Under other circumstances, you would have destroyed the whole earth, but you haven't done that, because you've got a plan for mankind. You love mankind and you don't want mankind to be destroyed. On the contrary, you want us all, everyone, man, woman and child, good, bad and ugly, all in your kingdom. You want us all to be there, and you've got a plan and purpose, and you're going to ensure that plan does succeed. Praise you, Father, for creating such a plan for mankind, and thank you for being who you are. We ask you to bless us continually and help us and always be with us, as you promise you will, to guide us and lead us through the Holy Spirit, so that we may walk the right path and not deviate from it. Follow Jesus Christ to the very end of our lives. Thank you for being who you are. Thank you for doing what you are doing in all of us. We praise your name and we bless you, Father, for being the great God you are. Help us to worship you and love you till the very end of our existence on this earth and forevermore in your kingdom. Thank you, and we ask all this in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
God will walk with me down streets where no one else will walk. God will talk with me about things of which no one else will talk. When no one else will walk, and no one else will talk, when no one will, God will.
God will bear with me the little worries no one knows are there. God God will care for me whenever there is no one else to care. When no one will be there and no one else will care, when no one will, God will. God will talk with me when friends forget and fail to understand. God will strengthen me when I am weak and need a helping hand. When no one understands or lends a helping hand, when no one will, God will. God will.